Yeah. Oh, something more electric.
Yeah. Yeah, that would be a good reason for him not joining those type of bands, I guess.
London.
He plays much more electric now. Yeah. In fact, I do gigs with him and wonder if he's going to play the guitar at all.
Yeah.
How come we were meeting and,
yeah,
what, and playing together?
No, but this, yeah, but that somehow, like, free music would have relation with rock music. It was electronic music.
Yeah, well, so many players were interested in lots of different situations. I mean, like, as an improviser, I wanted to play in different situations, but it still just sounded like me playing, even if it bent into a particular rhythmic area. And there are other people who did the same thing. I was a bit more interested than most in playing with a lot of people.
Yeah.
But, yeah, right back then, there was a lot of crossover, and of course, of the hippie thing as well. So you turn up at a festival and find you're suddenly, you've suddenly be joined by about 20 people, most with drums. Yeah, there was a real sort of lot of flowing all over the place, different musics mixing up.
No, but I mean, for example, like someone like Mike Oldfield.
Well, I knew him when he was 17, because we did Shooting at the Moon with Kevin Eyre's band. And yeah, we did a few odd gigs, mostly with Kevin, though.
Your room number?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, the thing, so many different things went on in the same places. I mean, you might go to a gig right through that 60s into the 70s thing, you'd go to a gig and there'd be six different kinds of music on the same gig. Yeah. And so you did meet lots of people.
But
I'm not saying all the crossover stuff was particularly good, but some of it was, and it's okay.
Much.
Yeah, well, Charlie's a very open man anyway, and I mean, he's always loved jazz.
Oh.
And Dave Green, the bass player, is his next door neighbour. They went to school together. And so he got more and more interested in doing the jazz things, and he comes and does gigs here and there. Has to choose a safe place, but he can do the 100 Club and it'll be filled because he's playing, but there won't be any problems.
But you don't think there was something, apart from the fact that there were so many players, there was something special in this place and time that made it?
I think it was a special time in that it gave people the chance to be open, and as an improviser, I like putting myself in these different situations where I still want to sound like myself, but can bend into different angles, because I was criticised for it a lot.
Mm.
I'm either criticised or people say they're surprised that I can play all these different kinds of music, but it's not necessarily that I play the different kinds of music, it's just that I play with them and can slot in. I don't want to become a rock player or any kind of player, but I like improvising in different situations. To other musics.
Yeah.
Well, that's what I would hope for, yeah. There would be no point in doing it.
In the middle of the 60s, there was, John Stevens founded a little theatre club.
Yeah, well, I was going there, that helped me a lot, yeah. I played their solo a few times, then started playing with him and Evan Parker and all the others.
How did you watch
that? That was really important. Oh yeah, from the start. Well, I was interested in that music more than anything else anyway.
Yeah.
But I liked doing the other things.
Right. How did you watch evolving the whole free jazz scene? Which was very, as we experienced it, very strong in London and Britain.
Yeah, there is a London music, isn't there? That early stuff with John and everyone at the Little Theatre Club, that's a very positive kind of music.
Yeah.
I meet people from other countries that really relate to that music and picked up on it.
But how did you how did you experience the process of evolving? So I think also Derek Bailey was playing traditional music in the beginning and then slightly developed into free music. So how did you watch that process in the 60s? Or how did you experience it yourself?
I think they were doing what I was doing, the same as Derek, really. I'm not playing differently, of course, but I was working sometimes with singers, and he was working with, I don't know if you know Gracie Fields, she's a bit of a ancient vocal heroine in England. He was working with her, and we were working with, not together, but working with cabaret artists and all kinds of people. Derek is probably one of the best straightforward players, if he wants to be, isn't he?
Yeah.
I mean, I've had him play ballads on some of my gigs just because he decided he would. Oh. Only a couple, two, I think. And I've known him for about 20 years. He doesn't want to do it, but he actually is one of the masters of that kind of music. But because he is an improviser, he doesn't want to bother with that, which I think is great.
Oh. But how did you come to free music? I'm sure you didn't woke up one morning and say, today I want to play free for the first time. So how did you experience this process?
Just through loving jazz more than most other music generally. I mean, when I was about 6 years old or so, my father was travelling around the world and he was listening to all kinds of music and bringing records. So I heard a lot of stuff. Early. I mean, the first soprano saxophone player I heard, except as part of a bigger band, was Sidney Bechet. I liked him.
Yeah.
So I was drawn to a certain extent to the soprano anyway, though I started on alto and tenor. I should listen to myself more while I'm talking. I'm forgetting what I'm talking about.
Oh, you came into free music.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, just natural development. I mean, I heard mostly from the jazz side, but I heard Lester Young through to Charlie Parker and right the way through that Coltrane, all of those people.
Yeah.
And listening to so-called serious contemporary music, so I had that side as well. Well, I mean, just some of the early electronics music and various composers. So that was another interest. I wasn't playing that music, but I liked it. And then just as the jazz side of things developed, I heard the new players. I heard Ornette Coleman, and I think about 10 of us heard him together, and everyone else thought it was rubbish, and I thought it was wonderful. I didn't know what he was doing. I realised now what he was doing was quite an apt thing to be doing, working with standards on that early thing. So just through hearing the music, liking it, and doing these long stretches of sometimes, well, when I was busking, nobody stopped me when I felt like it. I'd be mostly improvising or really extending compositions through improvisations. I started by playing short pieces and then found that a tune might last about 40 minutes and you only hear the tune in two halves, half at the beginning, half at the end. So it just developed from that, hearing all the music and then wanting to be, well, less preconceptions in playing.
You also played with Joe Harriott in the
only a few. He was a good friend of mine, but I only played with him a couple of times.
Yeah.
I think once in High Wycombe and a couple of times. I used to have a club in Aylesbury. But this was very early. I mean, I was playing tenor all right at the time. In fact, it's not that bad. The bit on the record's okay. But I don't think I would have dared to ask him to let me play with him if I'd gone to London and heard him. But I had to do the in-between bits in my own club, so he invited me to play him on my own gig. So I was like, if you want to play with a famous musician, give him money and bring him to your club. But I played with a lot of the good people. It really helped me, but I mean, I wasn't their class, but at least they liked me, so that's something.
What about the influence of Joe Harriott in late 50s?
Well,
I listened
to people, and if I liked them, I would try to do some of the things they did.
Yeah.
But then the important thing with people like that, and the way they've really affected me, is that they've made me really more interested in the music, but they've made me not want to play like them. I want to find something of my own.
Right.
But just so that's the real influence, to get you to the point where you don't want to try and play like them anymore. You just want to find something of your own. It doesn't have to be as good. I mean, I'll never be as good as most of my favourite players.